everybody. Thank you for being punctual in terms of your time. Unfortunately, sorry, we weren't quite so punctual around that as well. What we're going to now do is ask you to just work with in groups of either threes or fours, depending on where you how the numbers work out, but as a minimum group of three, maximum group of four, just to look at a particular scenario. We're not going to spend long on it, so it'll be fairly quick thoughts that you come up with in relation to the scenario that is up on the screen and also the scenario which is in your pack. What some of the activity is asking you to look at is what are the key points in the commissioning and procurement cycle, and what would you want to take take to maximise social value? What may be the barriers or the challenges around that, and also the opportunities for small businesses and organisations? What social value do you think was offered? And what tools and mechanisms and techniques would you propose to monitor the additional social value delivered through the contract? So it's just to get you thinking about things. If we could just spend 5 minutes within your respective groups, discuss amongst your near neighbours, jot down some points, and then from each side of the room, could ask you then, once you've jotted down some things, if you can just pop them up onto the wall, the respective walls either side, and then we'll then share back those points of summary. Okay? So, like I said, introduce yourselves to your near neighbour and have a good 5 minutes conversation. Thank you. Okay? In terms of the scenario, the station taxis contracted by Sunderland Council is a small business that is able to provide social value. They deliver benefit to the local area in ways that fit their business model. In brackets, that is, the additional services and benefits provided are natural adjunct to what they do. So the activity really was to look at some of the points, some of the thinking that we would go through in relation to the commissioning of that. And thank you for the points that you've raised. Guy's going to talk through some of those points as best he can.
Rather than going through stuff that I can't really hear, challenges. Okay, now let's. I don't think the scenario wasn't. I mean, I think I'll just add something to the scenario, if I may, because it's here you've got a taxi company and you're trying to understand the social value. Really, the scenario would be you're comparing a taxi company like this and Addison Lee or someone, a big provider. That, I think, is kind of interesting. How do you, and yet you know instinctively that this company is the one that ought to be getting the contract. So what are the challenges around that scenario, do you think, as opposed to just how you measure the social value of this? This man here had a lot to say earlier. what's your view of that particular challenge?
In that chapter, I think it's legislative in terms of proving you can do that on the objective basis as per the regulations which we're going to operate under. So you mentioned there that you have a gut feeling, obviously as public sector bodies, we're unable to take into account the gut feeling.
Because as private sector organisation, we can use our gut.
And we can't just what's on the paper there. And that then, I suppose, is directly related to the evaluation criteria you set down in the first place, which links back to the policies.
So how do you go about getting the evaluation criteria correct to ensure that the right organisation wins? What's the...
Like this. We're learning about it. That's what we're here for, to understand that really, and in terms of how do we do that objectively, because I think certainly from our organisation's perspective, we wouldn't know where to start currently in terms of objectively evaluating two different sort of...
Who's actually been involved in, assessment? How many organisations here actually have social value as a criteria against which they assess? Who uses it as a criteria, apart from Bristol? Anyone else?
You've got a social value policy.
So why did, because we just had this conversation earlier, and I'm just interested about how you went about assessment and the award. You don't need to go through the difficulties that you had, but nonetheless, there were some interesting issues around how you go about choosing and making that transparent.
Well, we picked sort of aspirations for the council. So the example I was talking about was, encouraging the uptake of school meals. So we just stated that as a criteria and said, what do you think you can do that would help us achieve that? And I think also making sure that your criteria sort of mentioned that it's within the boundaries of your particular council. I think that's quite helpful in favouring local companies because they're based there and then they're going to start, easy for them to do the social value within your boundaries.
And what percentage weighting did you have on social value?
We had, for that tender, we had 8%.
Eight. And Bristol, what do you guys, do you have it across all your contracts now?
Yes.
And what 10%. Percentage? 10%. And does anyone else have a weighting on social value?
We tend to use
10%. 10%. And that's set because, why 10%? I'm not saying it's wrong, but I'm just interested.
Pretty much because the users don't want to include a higher level. I would say that the people that I deal with.
When you say users, you mean the service?
The service
partners. Okay.
Interestingly, Birmingham have got up to 20%, so I was told, which I thought was very generous of the number run. But clearly, as you say, not relevant everywhere.
I'm going to tag to you now.
Sorry, to answer one of your earlier questions about one of the challenges, what do we need to do? There's a suggestion this side about needing to, at all points of the commissioning and procurement, to consider and review the social value policy to ensure it's regularly kept current. And I think there's something really important we highlighted this morning about very emerging field, very sort of early stage of development. So ensuring that at each point of the commissioning process that social value is considered, but equally allowing regular review points to ensure that it's still current and that you're still in line with best practice, etc. Some of the points, I'm not sure which group. Am I articulating it very well? I've given a post-it, I'm not giving much work.
I'm trying to be really optimistic.
Okay.
In fact, following the theory that if you were increasing the use of social value and your contract were to presumably would start addressing some of the social needs in your area, which may be the things you might have prioritised to start with, and redundant, it might need to be a new one. That would be really optimistic.
Interesting.
But it's a good place to be.
I like that. Thank you very much for sharing.
Just moving on to some of the things
that you could explore. There were three key themes came through with this particular example. One was about community transport links, creating additional value around community transport, reducing rates. So that's a strong theme. Another suggestion around creating local employment opportunities for difficult long-term unemployed people. And thirdly, there was something a suggestion around lower carbon emissions, or potentially the suggestion for using electric vehicles.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Carl. Thank you, Guy. Thank you, everybody, for the involvement on that one. So some of the points that again were summarised up onto the screen as there. And again, all of these points are in the pack in that respect. Thank you. Next activity or part of the agenda now is to hand over to colleagues at Bristol to get a feel in relation to some of the work that Bristol have been doing, and I shall, without further ado, hand across to the Bristol team. Thank you.
Right. Bristol's been working on maximising employment training commitments for quite a long time through the planning process, and in fact, with the introduction of SIL, we made the decision to move beyond Section 106, which we still have to get some money in, to start introducing a requirement as a planning condition for developers over a certain size to agree an employment and training strategy with the council before they can get planning consent on a development. And this includes the standard things, apprenticeships, training, local recruitment, but also monitoring. And this has started to allow us not only to raise the awareness of employment and training commitments, but also to start getting a better picture of what is happening on developments in the city. And this, in a lot of ways, provided the basis for moving into employment and training commitments, shaping what we're doing around employment and training commitments through social value. Bristol's now a learning city, I believe the first one in England, and the one of the four main priorities of the learning city is learning for and in work. So there is a challenge group for that that has identified increasing employment skills commitments through procurement, through council procurement, as one of its three main priorities for the first year of its activities. And we, in fact, have to report to them regularly on what we're doing towards achieving this. In the last few months, it's become even more important because we now have a new mayor who has a very strong focus on reducing inequality and employment and training opportunities, particularly for more disadvantaged communities, are one of his very high priorities. So it's been going up and up the agenda. So inevitably, the first area that we focused on for social value through procurement was, in fact, construction. Because we had the experience, and also because the construction sector is much more aware of this, it's much easier to work with them. And we had a very major development in the Bristol Arena, which is going through the final stages of procurement of the construction element, which was one of our first major achievements in terms of what social value they can offer. Obviously, that was major developers. It's a £50-60 million contract. It's only going to be the very big boys going for it. But then over the 6 months since then, particularly since the social value policy came into practice in Bristol, we've had quite a range of different contracts in which we have included social value as part of the procurement process. And it's been a really interesting learning curve, because I would say 6 months ago, only the bigger contractors gave convincing social value responses. And going back to your question earlier, they obviously knew what to do, knew where to go, had people who were experienced in offering what was asked and offering more than was asked. So while the question in terms of what social value we are looking for in, when we're talking about construction tends to be around apprentices, other training, inclusive training for our priority groups, local recruitment, and monitoring information. What is interesting, there is then an other question. And the responses to the other question, what else you can do, are becoming more and more interesting, and I say over a very short period. So that recently I scored, only a couple of weeks ago, a very large number of social value responses in relation to a housing repair contract. I can't give any details because it's still going through. But what was very interesting is the majority of those were local businesses. The majority of them were local SMEs looking to sign up to a framework. And virtually all of them were making very convincing and often quite exciting social value offers reflecting their local communities. This is partly because, I will say, the construction procurement team have done really active work talking to them, trying to raise awareness of what the possibilities are and of what the requirements are. It's not enough to say, I'm a local business and therefore I employ local people. You know, I may know that that local business is going to provide social value in the local area, but if you don't tell me, it's like a job application. If it's not written down, as you said before, if it's not written down, we can't score it. And getting this message across to the bidders is proving really important. So it is proving a very sharp learning curve within, and what we're now doing is moving beyond construction, and particularly in two ways. Talking to the commissioners, because I find that the commissioners are often as scared as the bidders, and I'll get a phone call saying, what's this about? And we sit down for an hour and talk about the full range of what social value could be, i.e. it's not how many apprentices are you going to provide, that's not the be-all and end-all. And they go away really excited. But we are also trying to introduce it at a much earlier stage in the procurement process. So not just at market engagement events, but even earlier at sort of, I'm doing tomorrow a market warming event, which is as much as anything else to get the market's impressions about the overall idea of this new procurement exercise. But at that point, we're going to have a slot on social value. So they start being aware of what the image of social value is long before it goes out to tender. In the idea that they can then have long enough to start thinking about it. So we're learning very fast ourselves. It's only 6 months since our policy came into force. And I would say that the difference in those 6 months has been dramatic and actually quite exciting. I'm longing for this particular procurement exercise to be completed so we can start making some of the case studies and the offers public, because some of them were really exciting, going well beyond employment and training commitments, but really offering value across a whole range of community issues. And that's from local SMEs, not from the big players.
Can I just ask a question before you move on? Is that all right? I'm from the University of Exeter. We know virtually nothing about social value, although we do have social value features incidentally in some of our contracts. I'm really interested in what you're saying about scoring bids, because you've already said earlier this afternoon that, you know, we can apply a weighting to social value, but we don't actually have to say anything more than that. We just leave it up to companies, etc., to come forward with ideas and suggestions. So I'm interested around the scoring side of submissions, particularly in relation to social value suggestions. What for you are the key features of a good social value bid? In terms of the social value element on its own. So what scores maximum marks and what scores low marks?
Right. If you take it depends on what we've asked.
Yeah.
So what we would do normally is say what the issue is that we're trying to resolve through the social value element of this contract, how and what particular outcomes we would look for in relation to that. Give an indication of what level of outcome. So to take the chestnut, so many apprenticeships per so many million pounds of delivery. And then, as I say, another question, what else can you do? So if I'm scoring, if someone comes in and just offers what the minimum that we've asked for, that's acceptable. No, they've offered what we ask. If someone looks at the same obvious areas, the main indicators we've mentioned, and offers more than the minimum that we've suggested, then that is a better score. If they offer that and then offer something completely different extra, then that's going to be an even better score. So to get an acceptable, we score on 1 to 5.
But you're still being prescriptive in terms of what you're expecting them as a minimum to
come. To a certain extent, yeah, we would give a minimum, because otherwise you can't say acceptable or non-acceptable.
Because I think that's probably
the
difficulty we would have is in articulating what those minimums should be. We're not social value experts. How do we know what a reasonable number of apprentices on a construction contract or on a financial services contract, how does that fit? I think that's the difficulty we have, is not having that confidence So if someone did challenge because, say, they lost on that, they said, well, we've done X and Y and you haven't scored that, or you didn't consider that, it was just in the kind of other box, and so-and-so scored a little higher in another area. Is it, how is that defensible?
Yeah, so how do we defend ourselves? You have to talk to the... there will be experts within your organisation and on these fields, really. And it's not just a procurement person setting the indicators. You've got to do, if it's something to do with construction, you don't talk about to people who know about construction, what is it reasonable to ask about? If it's financial services, talk to whoever is dealing with financial exclusion or financial education. What do they, if that's the issue that you choose, what do they think a reasonable offer would be?
I suppose the practical points that you're making there really are sort of be clear around what you want, what you're asking, and then how you can then describe what good looks like. I think is the, you know, if you can think about it from, well, what does good look like? You know, how many jobs would that be? How much financial investment into the community? Or
so the issue I have with that approach is, if you're saying we require as a minimum one, two, whatever, then if I was a bidder, I'm going to, knowing that everyone's doing that, I'll probably add a cost into that contract to cover that, because everyone's doing it. And that, so you're kind of raising the bar, which is fine. If you've got more money to spend, that's okay. But if you don't, then I'm not sure it's going to... it just seems like if I was a bidder, I might actually be tempted to...
Is it not naive to think that companies that add additional social value add cost into their bid, even though it's not specified in the bid?
Well, I don't know. Our experience is no. If you leave it totally... as long as you don't include it as a core part of the contract, i.e. everyone's going to do it. If you say you've got to do one apprentice per million quid or whatever it is, everyone will do that and everyone will allow for that cost. If you leave it open, then they know that they could win it on social value, but they could win it, lose it on cost if the cost is too high. So you leave them to make that decision. And you'll find, certainly in our experience, the Harrow job I told you about, 9 bids, the lowest bidder had the highest social value. Not quite like that, but not far off. No, I don't mean just in terms of the number. If you're specifying, I think there's just a challenge around.
What we've actually done is give an aspiration. I think we phrase it as Bristol City Council's aspiration is. Right. Okay. And it's an indicative number. also, because we can't say how many local people we would like and what percentage of their workforce we would like from a local area, that's illegal. But we can give an aspiration. And in some cases, they can say, well, we can give you 100% because we're a local company and everybody lives locally.
Are these
correct?
Mandatory?
Sorry?
Are these mandatory?
No. Your aspiration.
I think in terms of expedience, in terms of the session, really, really interesting piece of conversation, because I think that, again, demonstrates some of the challenges that we have around commissioning and procuring activity when considering social value. So if we can... equally take some very practical points from April's presentation in terms of early market warming, early engagement with the commissioners, and also the potential to share case studies and learning. Again, I think those are important points, doable, practical points that we can all take away from that as well. I'm mindful of time. I'm also mindful that there's also more that in terms of Bristol wishes to move forward with. So could I ask for...
I'm going to sort of truncate what I was going to say quite a lot, because I think actually quite a lot's already been covered, because Guy has talked about TOMs, the themes, outcomes, and the measures. When we started doing this piece of work, one of the exercises I did was to go through our fairly substantial raft of existing performance measures across a whole range of business areas and just map them against our corporate themes and try to make some connections between what our current corporate themes and what social value looks like. That was quite instructive, because I'm not a procurement expert. My world is sort of performance and business improvement. So I have a lot of discussions with service managers, so that not the procurement experts, about how are you delivering the business and your service areas that you need to report on in our corporate plan. And obviously within the procurement framework, you have the two sections around award criteria, where providers are perhaps asked to set out their intended measures. And then these turn into performance obligations. And it's really important, I would be saying to service managers, it's really important to know what needs to be measured and how you're going to measure that robustly, but also proportionately, because we know smaller organisations are not set up to do all the monitoring, measuring, counting of stuff, which possibly as local authority people and other public bodies sitting here, we know in the past we've been able to do. So the sort of questions I would be asking service managers to think about in terms of the discussion I guess they then have with our procurement colleagues to turn their thinking into an appropriate procurement process would be about how would you measure your own success? What evidence do you already collect about you knowing that what you're delivering works? And that can be everything from nuts and bolts of pure outputs through to outcomes and impact. And I think impact measurement has been a matter of discussion for more years than I care to remember, really. But it's quite good to remind service managers about that. And it's also really important not to contrive made up measures that just look nonsense and they're all what I call but smoke and mirrors. They might look great, but they don't really say anything. Proportionality is really important. And I'm sure that we'll come to a point where we've got potential bidders asking us about what assessment packages would you recommend, and generally as a local authority, I guess we're not into recommending that people use a particular tool or model. But I think what we're hoping to do is to come up with a shopping list of ways to approach this. Certainly within the SME, the VCS sector, the question to ask is what support can be given for them. So within Bristol we've got Cars organisation, we've got Fosca, who are our sort of big support for local and community organisations. There will, I think, become an increasing amount of sort of support and case studies available. It is quite early days, and I think that's what everybody's grappling with a little bit. And I guess in the same way as service managers need to keep that ongoing review of how they're delivering services within the contract sort of environment, that same level of review is critical. And the importance of good contract management, I think, and that's not necessarily a very aggressive contract management style, but that importance of ongoing dialogue within contracts is really important. And I'm going to stop.
So, over to me. Thank you, Steve. Thank you. The advantage of going last is that lots of my content has been picked up by my colleagues, which is great. We've put lots more content into the slide pack that we will get up on the web pages shortly, so do have a look. There are some hints and tips in there. If you've got any questions, do feel free to send an email in. And if there are sufficient questions, we'll develop an FAQ sheet to go alongside the resource pack that we share today. Carl? So, from me, as a procurement colleague to you, just some key messages. This was a late night slide, by the way, just because the rest looked so sort of mundane. But just to say, don't panic. We know this stuff. The language is different, but actually we've been doing outcomes-based commissioning for a while. We've used performance specs opposed to technical specs for a while. We've been incorporating sustainability. We've long been evaluating case studies and method statements or delivery models that can be based on the same performance spec but look really different. So we've often had that kind of, this one says this and that one says that, and I like these elements of that one, not so much about that. So there is no solution to that, there's no answer. It's about us as professionals, when we're evaluating, having the right subject matter experts in the room and part of that evaluation panel, and recognising that there is some subjectivity within that. And my advice would be, ensure that we've got a really robust audit trail as to how we've arrived at that decision. You know, it isn't always going to be black and white, but then there are other scenarios that also aren't always black and white. And equally, we've long tried to measure intangibles. So again, that's tricky, particularly in social care. We've looked at impact, which again can be quite subjective around distance travelled and those type benefits. And we've long grappled with monetising, measuring and monitoring. So no answers for you today, but just to recognise that when we start using the language around social value, I think we panic because we think this is new, this is different, this isn't something we're familiar with, when actually it is. That yellow worm, by the way, was meant to be the golden thread. But I couldn't find any golden thread. So it's a yellow worm. I kind of knew where I was going at the time. But just to say, and that's a rocket, because my point was it's not rocket science, but actually looking at it from a distance, I'm not sure what that looks like now. And that's Mr. Benjamin Franklin, who quite famously said, well, I can't read from here, but basically, failing to be prepared is preparing to fail, or words to that effect. So the point there is, the earlier we start the dialogue with the market and experts and one another as commissioners and procurement experts, the better. So what I would say is come together as the professionals and look at what the potential benefits and impacts could be, and then as April said, take that to the market as early as you can and say, this is what we seek to secure through this tender. What do you think? Is it achievable? Is it proportionate? Is it relevant? Is it linked to the core subject matter of your business? And the market will tell us very quickly what is within the gift of what's reasonable, what's proportionate, what is the art of possible. And we recognise, although we've got a policy and toolkit, we don't know what we don't know at this stage. It's so early, so we've been really clear within our guidance documents that they are, you know, kind of subject to change based on the evidence and learning that we accumulate as we go. And I think we're all in the same boat, really, on that one. So, you know, what I would say is, let's not kick ourselves, actually. We've included some examples of social value, just in case you get that moment of, actually, I'm not sure where to start here. Equally, within our toolkit document, what Kate kindly did was looked at our performance indicators as an authority and linked some social value related outcomes to those. So again, it's not the kind of the final piece, we're still developing that, but it gives our commissioners and the market something to think about. The advantage of the legislation as it is, in that it's not too prescriptive. So what that means is we can be a bit innovative, we can test things out, you know, as long as we're aware of that, so that we're not tying our providers into unachievable contract performance that we as a local authority couldn't achieve if we delivered, let alone our provider market, then we're okay. And that comes from that relationship through contract management and, I think as Kate said, the ongoing dialogue with our providers to ensure that we're securing the additional social value that we've sought, but we're not being unreasonable within that, and we're not penalising our providers for not being able to deliver something that is so new and sometimes so innovative that we jeopardise the core of our contract, so whatever the thing that we were buying in the first place was. That's not a very good slide there, and actually what I've left off is our members and our senior leadership team. Apologies for that. But the gist is, what I wanted to share with you is, as a public sector body, we can write a policy, have a toolkit, decide where we're going with this. Unless we work with our key delivery partners locally and beyond, such as organisations like Social Enterprise Works, we work closely locally with the Federation of Small Business and Bosca, who are an umbrella organisation supporting our BCS. Unless we work together to understand what is reasonable, what is achievable, what are the challenges and barriers for us as a public sector, but also for the market that actually we're actively trying to engage with and level that playing field, we won't be successful, because we need to understand what some of the issues are from our market providers to enable us to target the support we give, so that we don't inadvertently penalise them within trying to secure social value. So what that looks like in Bristol is a really close relationship with some of our key partners in the city, and some development sessions and that free flow of information, so that we can understand, as our policy and our approach evolves, what some of those issues may be. So we do have a policy in Bristol. It's in no way the final piece. You know, we've put together in partnership what we thought we could do within the policy, but it's not there yet, and we know that. And we will go back to Cabinet and scrutiny early next year with a revision to that. So what we've learned so far, we'll build in, Carl. What I would share with you is that within that policy, we've identified what we term as priority organisations, and that was because we quite openly talk about SMEs, but sometimes we forget the micro, or we don't forget them, but we don't necessarily specify them, the voluntary community sector and social enterprises. So at the moment, the data and intelligence we've got isn't sufficient to allow us to extract any particular kind of part of the sector and say we're performing well in this area, but actually we know that we need to target groups of and for people with protected characteristics, or those type kind of nuggets that enable us to shape the support and development we offer. So we've got a fairly broad kind of group within our priority organisations. I envisage that as we move forward, we're able to further target groups within that classification as we go. What that meant was we can keep the term priority organisations, but be flexible within that in future iterations of the policy and toolkit. Thank you, Carl. So just to show you some aims of the policy, they might be different for you as a local area, they might be similar. Thanks, Carl. And to support the policy, we've developed a toolkit, and that is, it is, yeah. And we've got a resource page on the slide pack where I've dropped various things, so the case studies that Margaret mentioned, some of the unit cost databases that Kate's referred to, and the link to the policy and toolkit. So you're more than welcome to look at that if you want a Word version, so that you can type over and stick new pictures on. That's absolutely fine. You know, we've developed this in partnership with a view to it being shared, so we're not precious. And actually our own toolkit, if I'm honest, was based on the toolkit of other local authorities like Baines, like Manchester, like Croydon. So lots of things like the case studies and the tools that you'll find are actually similar across all the toolkits. So yeah, just... I'm hurrying up. So, key points in the cycle. The key is, as Kate said, as early as possible, as transparent as possible, allow stakeholders to shape our approach. Thanks, Carl. Skip that one. Some points there on supporting priority organisations, slash your SMEs and your BCSs. Any questions, come back to us on that. As Kate and April mentioned, we've published a sample social value question. So what that's got is the guidance to providers on what a good response would look like, some things to think of. Because what we've found, thanks, Carl, is that, skip that one, is that the more we give, the more we get. So where we've gone out with a question, what additional social value will you bring, we've had one line responses and we've had War and Peace. And that didn't feel fair. So what we've done is given as much information about what our appetite through this contract in terms of social value outcomes would look like. And then that allows the providers to shape their response. What we've done in Bristol is made a commitment to increasing our procurement spend to at least 25% with our priority organisations. But what we recognise is in setting 10% of our quality weighting of our award criteria against social value, potentially we could rule out the very groups that we're trying to target. Hence, we're doing some more developmental work and engaging so closely with the representative bodies that we've got locally. I've put there some measuring resources. Thank you, Carl. Skip that. Some steps through to policy development, if it helps, but do use that. This was developed before the Social Value Portal and the Social Value Best Practice Task Force toolkit was released. So do use that in conjunction with your action plan. Carl, thank you. Next steps for us, it's all about the bigger picture. So in Bristol, we've got a mayor who's committed to developing a corporate social responsibility charter for Bristol. So that means that our social value work now moves into a bigger piece of work that will link to other activities such as the modern savoury statement and those type of things. So it's really exciting stuff for us at the moment. Thank you, Carl.
Thank you very much, Jacqueline. I mean, I noticed there's an opportunity for questions there. We've got a wider session for questions now. So perhaps to bring us back in a little bit onto time, if we can move forward with questions from the floor. If you want to open up questions to the panel, like I said, you've heard some very practical examples of what Bristol are doing in terms of implementing social value, and also from our panel of experts. So please feel free to use the opportunity to explore more. Yeah.
To the Bristol team, what would you say is your critical success factors in embedding all of this in your organisation? Obviously, you've got three of you, which I don't know, are you dedicated to kind of pushing this through? Have you had that support from up on above to resource people like you to be able to go out and run across the organisation, speak with the service managers and push that? How did you get that embedded in? You know, what sort of resistance do you have to overcome to get that? So, you know, obviously, it's a really key factor you just mentioned there, your mayor's pushing this. Is it helpful to have that at that high level? Is that what sort of pulled it through?
I would say it's essential to get that member and senior leadership buy-in. So we've been really, really fortunate in that we did have a particular member last year who was a massive champion of social value and was able to communicate some of the quite technical messages actually around procurement back to other members and really championed the cause within Cabinet. And then we had a new mayor come in this year who's very committed to corporate social responsibility. So that's kind of given us that level of support from that aspect. We are colleagues, so we're sharing our learning and practice and approaches with our peers. That's quite valuable. So you're not being told from upon high, but we're working together. We haven't been given additional resource per se, but we have modified our roles to champion social value within the organisation. And I can't stress enough how essential having those relationships with market leaders such as Social Enterprise Works and the Federation of Small Business and the VCS have been in terms of communicating the messages. So last year we did a provider satisfaction survey with procurement, and actually the number of people that indicated they weren't familiar with social value was quite low, and we've redone that exercise this year and it's peaked. So we're really pleased. So somewhere along the line between those three strands, the message is getting over, and that's what we need. And as April said, we're seeing a better quality and level of social value commitment, which, let's be honest, lots of smaller organisations have been delivering social value, not even using that language, but actually doing stuff for a long time, and as procurement professionals, we've not even been able to ask them and score as part of our tenders actually what they're doing and be able to recognise that and exploit it within our contract. So I'm really pleased. And that's when I say, you know, it's not rocket science, it's not new, because to lots of us it isn't. It's just a different approach to what we're familiar with. Does that answer your question? Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions around the panel? Does anyone have any advice about the sort of evaluation stage in the tender process? Evaluating social value in terms of differentiating between what a supplier is going to do for you under that contract and what they're actually going to do anyway, particularly in areas such as, you know, employment, apprenticeships, but also things like sustainability, where it all sort of emerges sometimes, isn't it?
It's really tricky, and I think it's looking at what you're delivering as a provider through our contract. So it's about us using the right form of words. We've had some tender submissions that have told us what they've done elsewhere, which is beautiful, but doesn't tell us what you're delivering within our contract. What I would say is we'd welcome any and all additional social value at the moment. We're not yet kind of expert enough to be able to pull out, actually, this is what you would deliver anyway, and this is what you're delivering in addition because you've got this contract.
Guy?
It has to be a separate question. You have to ask separately. And I think it's really important for the Commissioner to understand that even if the intrinsic social value is not the same as additional social value. And that's really important. It's really important, particularly with ones like social care, where everything they're doing is social value. That is not what we're talking about. It's got to be additional.
Yeah, and I think make sure that in the ITT, in fact, PQQ, ITT, building capacity, every stage, this is about, we call it SVA, social value add, additional social value. So I'll give you an example. So our first project, pilot study, you always learn through pilots. So we did this with Lambeth, and it was a digital, it was called DigiBuddies. So it's a digital inclusion programme. And the price was just £70,000. But that £70,000 was buying coordination of 100 volunteers. And we didn't make it clear in the contract. And so what we got back is social value. The social value coming back using our methodology was like £1 million worth of social value on a £70,000 contract. And the reason was that people had put in 100 times and each person was going to give 1,000 hours. You're like, oh my God, you know, suddenly. But of course, everyone had that. So, and we learned from that, you've got to be precise about, you know, what is it you're measuring, and that it's got to be additional, above and beyond the core contract. Otherwise, you can get into all sorts of trouble.
It can be quite hard to differentiate anyway.
Yeah, I mean, yes, it can be hard, but I think it's possible. We've done it since, many times, and so you've just got to be... we've learned from the mistakes, for sure.
Steve, can I just throw up something, go back to an earlier question, and also reflecting on sitting in a room full of colleagues of yours in Bristol, commissioning managers, who were asking us about what do we ask for? How do we know what to ask for? How do we know where to start, etc.? And you can't really read this, but it's in the toolkit, which will be a link on the slides, that colleagues in Bristol, as I mentioned, you've all got strategic plans with your local authorities. So mapping out some of the outcomes that within your sort of corporate strategies, I suppose, and sort of mapping out particular areas, some of the examples given here around addressing inequalities or healthy care in Bristol, and some of the sort of potential outcomes and measure, social value measures that are either already written there that you could sort of be asking and requesting, or additionally making it easier for colleagues to understand some examples of the potential sorts of social value that you could be asking for in relation to those strategic outcomes. So it's certainly worth a look, depending upon what part of that stage that you're at, just to sort of help to give a rounded picture about the sorts of things that you might wish to align. And again, going to the point about getting senior level buy-in, if you can convince your powers that be that you're helping address your
corporate strategic issues.
Seems like a pretty good business case to me.
Yeah, good.
Just one more thing. You can ask the market, as Jacqueline said, consult with the market early on about what they think they can offer. Because we can tell them the general area, or we can say to them what could be offered.
And help them shape.
And they can help shape what they will then be asked to do, because they are aware of what they can do, but they need support and ideas, I think.
And just to add that, when you're having that conversation, ask how they monitor and measure, because we've really grappled with that, and actually some providers are doing that as part of other funding arrangements, so they'll be much further down the line than we are in terms of monitoring and measuring some of those, particularly what we'd call the less tangible impacts and outcomes.
Margaret, did you want to add a point there?
Well, it wasn't really a point. I actually wanted to ask the floor a question.
Okay.
Well, I won't ask the floor. I'll ask you guys. I touched on it. Guy touched on it. I think everybody who's spoken has touched on it. That we're early days. You know, Social Value Act itself is only a few years old. It's been through one review, and we've also reflected from the kind of survey Guy did with you and the national survey that I reflected, that there's a high proportion of followers. What would you need or want, either locally in the Southwest or from national government support, or where could the support come from? It doesn't need to be government, it could be, I don't know, I suppose that's the question I'm asking, to get you to move from being a follower to an adopter to an enabler. You know, you've sat through this couple of hours, hopefully you've taken something, made you think about it a little bit further. What next? What's next for you?
I would say something like we shouldn't be relying on Bristol City Council to be producing toolkits and giving guidance and examples. That's fantastic, they've done that, it's amazing that they're sharing, but if this is something which is coming on in from the government, then that kind of toolkit type thing, especially having the ability with you and your colleagues to see what people are doing all around the country, rather than, you know, this isn't restricted to the Southwest, what's Scotland doing, what Wales doing, you know, and pull that together and have that in a sort of central resource where we know where it is and when we can take a look at that. I think that would be supremely helpful and certainly a start.
Okay, thank you.
And I'd like to add to that, if I may, some training to go with it, even if we have area-specific champions that then bring that back and disseminate back to us.
Yeah, anything else from around the floor to steps or what more could be done?
I think in terms of guidance, I think I can see the links for social value on councils and local authorities quite easily. I think for wider public sector bodies like universities, like the fire department, the police, etc., I don't think it's quite so clear.
I think it's very clear with fire. Police, they do it anyway. I think it's clear with fire. I think it's particularly clear, actually.
But for higher education, it's a great point, because ultimately the Act is for public bodies.
Yeah.
And local authorities are clearly those most sort of impacted, particularly in the challenging climate. But you're absolutely right. There are a number of other public bodies that are less receptive, less engaged. And again, in a sort of locality, and we're still yet to sort of crack this nut in Bristol, and I'm sure we've all got lots of work to do in our respective geographies. But I guess sharing across the platform, it's not just the local authority levels.
It's really health as well.
And I suppose, Margaret, that's probably the challenge back to you now, is to how to break it into the harder to reach public sector bodies and organisations as well. So, you know, how we can manage that.
I probably shouldn't say this, but it's stating a public obvious. The Social Value Act actually identified that central government was one of the poorest performers. So, you know...
Yes, yeah, okay. Yeah. So there's more to do in that sense, okay. Further points from around the floor?
I'm going to put a question back to the floor, then, just wondering on the next steps. Okay. I heard somebody over the break, but I'm curious in the room. Has today been useful? Are you going to do anything differently? What are you going to take away from today? What learning have you captured? What eureka moments have we sparked? Would anybody be willing to give us a bit of feedback as to how you're feeling, what you're thinking?
Yep, here we go. Couple, yeah.
For me, I was talking to one of my own colleagues on the table, it's kind of crystallising the other things that are going on in Torbay. Actually, this feeds into it really well, and actually, it's a perfect time to get things moving.
Okay, excellent. So.
I'm from one of those organisations. Where it's in, my background was in sustainable
Excellent. Good. Excellent. It's a positive thumbs up. Anyone else want to share anything before we do a final close? There were a couple of points that I've taken down as next steps, really, and certainly from one of the early parts of the conversation was, is there an activity that we as the South West Region can do to actually draw together some common themes around what social value could mean to the region and how those could be reflected in terms of what we do as well. How we can better link in with the national agenda, and again, you know, I think it's been really beneficial to have, you know, Margaret here as well, that is catalyst and link between, central government and the public sector in the South West region. So thank you very much for that. How we can use perhaps Margaret to influence, areas that we potentially are struggling with, or areas where we feel that we could have more support. And I suppose it's each and beholden to on each and every one of us to sort of go back into our organisations and look to influence the impact that social value can have, raise awareness and promote that both internally in the organisation, but also starting to have the, if we're not already doing it, the dialogue with the private and voluntary sectors in our communities. So thank you all very, very much for your attendance. I would like to again thank Guy for your wisdom, Carl for your wisdom as well, and again Margaret equally, and also to the Bristol team as well. So thank you very much.